Good morning, Christ Church. Welcome. My name is Don Frazier. I'm the worship pastor. I'd like to ask you all to stand with me as we prepare to go into a time of worship. Let's begin our worship this morning by reading together and praying together this prayer that you see on the screen. Let's read it together. O Lord, open our lips, and our mouth shall proclaim your praise. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Welcome for joining us on Facebook on Live. Let's sing together.
My God is the light.
darkness fades into new beginnings as we lift our eyes to a hope beyond. All creation waits with an expectation to declare the reign of the Lord our silence breaks in the name of Jesus as the heavens cry, let the earth respond. All creation shouts with a voice of triumph to declare the reign of the Lord our God. Yeah. We will not be moved when the earth is
forever changed, forever changed. You call me your friend, brought into your endless kingdom. By the blood I was made, no longer a slave, and now you're taking us high. Death can shake us. The victor has won, and heaven has come, and now you're taking us higher.
Come on, church, let's sing it out.
Rushing
only found every voice. You chase me down, you seek me out. How could I be lost when you have called me found? Come on. You chase me down, you seek me out.
Amen. Let's pray this morning. God, we come before you today so thankful for your love, for your grace. Abba, Father, let us all just picture in our mind at the beach walking in the water and then your love just crashing over us. This huge wave maybe we're trying to get away from and we can't run from it. Just crashing over us. We don't deserve it. We can't earn it. And it never fails, your love for us. So God, as we hear your word today, I pray that you would get us pumped up, that you would get us to be compassionate, energize us for your word today. I pray that you would speak through Mike. You would continue to bless each person that is in this congregation and set them on fire for your kingdom. Have us to do what you would want us to do in our lives because of your never-ending love for us. Pray this in your name. Amen. Hey, everybody. My name is Zach Funk, and I'm the student director. I'm a little bit excited this morning because we just got back from a revival of a week at camp with these guys over here with our student ministry. It was incredible. The kids were awesome. The leaders were fantastic. And we are excited to be here. We're excited that y'all are here worshiping with us today at Christ Church. Please take a moment to greet those around you. Y'all can have a seat. We're going to get into the word this morning. If you've got your Bibles with you, let's flip to the book of Ruth, chapter 1, verses 15 through 18. Ruth 1, 15 through 18. And let's read this. Look, Naomi said to her, your sister-in-law has gone back to her people and to her gods. You should do the same. But Ruth replied, don't ask me to leave you and turn back. Wherever you go, I will go. Wherever you live, I will live. Your people will be my people, and your God will be my God. Wherever you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. May the Lord punish me severely if I allow anything but death to separate us. When Naomi saw that Ruth was determined to go with her, she said nothing more. The word of God for the people of God.
God is good.
All
and all the time. Glad to be with you this morning. You're joining us online. We welcome you in as well. We pray that God uses this entire worship service to bless you. Go ahead and share this so other people can hear about Jesus. My name is Mike. I'm the associate pastor here. Reverend Shane, our senior pastor, and Melissa are on vacation. Let's pray for them as they get rest and rejuvenation. All right, we are in our second week of this new summer series that we're calling Distracted, and we're trying to stay focused on Jesus in this fallen world. Well, due to the information age and social media age, there's more facts and opinions and myths and slanted stories in our path than ever. There's more to distract us from our relationship with God than ever before. With all these things distracting us, it can be really hard to maintain a focus on Jesus. Why? Because there's always something coming in our way to distract us from spending time with God. Let's quickly look at five signs that show that we are distracted. This is what research says. Let's just quickly look at these five signs of people who are distracted. First of all, people who are distracted tend to take on too many tasks. They say yes to about everything. When we say yes, when we have a tendency to say yes, 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 and never no, well, our lives can become untenable. Two, people who are distracted, they lose sight of their personal mission. Whatever it is that God has called us to do personally, that call on our lives as individuals, well, whenever we're distracted, we can begin to lose sight of that personal mission. Thus, our personal mission does not overflow into all areas of our life like it should. Next, three, distracted people tend to be unorganized. Distracted people have almost no organization in their lives. And I know there's some people who are organized, organized, organized. I'm not saying that if you're really focused on Jesus, you have you have everything organized in your life. However, if you have a focus on Jesus, there's no doubt that areas of your life should have organization over them. Number four, people who are distracted can procrastinate. We're going to keep putting that one off, okay? We're going to wait another week to do that one again. All right, number five, and I know that bugged people last week. I heard about that. They're like, you never got to that in your sermon. I say, well, yeah, I'm having fun. All right, I'm going to keep having fun. All right, number five, and finally, people who are distracted have a tendency to dwell in the past. Oftentimes, people who are distracted have something in their past that they can't move beyond. It doesn't mean that there's something in our past that still bothers us a little bit. This is more of a stronghold type of thinking, meaning that there's something in our past that we keep going back to. Every time God starts to pull us out and starts to take that step, we keep thinking to the past and it just brings us back. It's more of a stronghold. And people who are distracted oftentimes has that thing that just keeps yanking them back. Well, I'm a father to two young girls, Nora and Ava. Well, I enjoy being a father. I'm enjoying to watch these girls grow. My wife and I are experiencing these fun and meaningful times with our young girls. Let me give an example. Like the other evening, we went outside and we caught fireflies in the yard. Has anyone done that with children or grandchildren this last year or so? Yeah, it's so fun. My wife, my daughters, and I caught, no joke, we caught a lot of them. We had to have about 100 fireflies in this small bug container. It was a lot of fun, and there were a lot around us. And it was an evening last week that was kind of cool. So my assumption is they don't fly as fast when it's cool. I didn't check that out, but that's just what was going on in my mind. Well, being outside with my wife and my children in a moment like that will probably be one of my highlights of 2019. You know, one of those moments you don't really think much about, and then it's such a fun moment. You're like, oh, that was really awesome. Well, when we got inside the house, we only had all these fireflies in one bug container. And so my wife said to my older daughter and my younger daughter, said, okay, you two can sleep in the same room tonight. Why? Because I'm not going to divide up those 100 fireflies into two different containers, you know, because they were going to keep them in the room and you can't have just one in, you know, one room. It would have been a nightmare. So they go to my older daughter Nora's room to spend the night in her room together. As time went on, they're both laughing and talking about the bugs and looking at those things, kind of squirming around. And then as time goes on, my six-year-old, she starts to get quiet. She's starting to ready to go to sleep. But my three-year-old is nonstop talking, chatterbox, chatter. What's she talking about? No one knows. She just talks and talks and talks. Finally, me and my wife in the living room after a few minutes heard the six-year-old say to the three-year-old, Ava, I know. She said, I'm sorry. If you need to talk, Ava, that's fine, but do the talking in your head. You know, times like that makes it easy to be a father. It's fun, it's memorable, and I think what it does is it produces the sweetness of life. There are other times I'm not too thrilled about being a dad. One of those, something that falls in that category is watching princess movies. I'm not a princess movie fan, and I've watched this one movie many times now. Many of you know it, the 1991 animated version of Beauty and the Beast. Let me tell you a little bit about that movie because I've been forced to watch it. Beauty and the Beast focuses on the relationship between two characters, a prince who was cursed and transformed into a monster, Beast. Why is he transformed and cursed? Because of his arrogance. The other character in this movie is Belle, a young and intelligent and beautiful woman whom the Beast imprisons in his castle and hopes that she will fall in love with him, because if she falls in love with him, the curse will be broken. If the curse isn't broken, he is going to be a beast the rest of his life. Throughout the film, chemistry is being built up between the Beast and Belle, and all seems to be going well for the Beast, like the curse is going to be lifted. Except, how could the true curse truly be lifted if Belle was a prisoner? Love and freedom go hand in hand. She would need to choose to truly fall in love with the Beast, and freedom is a part of that. Well, Beast gives Belle the choice to stay, and he gives Belle the choice to go. There are some clear emotions that take place in this part of the movie. You can feel that the Beast wants Belle to stay, and Belle, she wants to stay, but her heart is also with her father. And at that point in the story, Belle decides to leave the Beast and go and take care of her father. Now, if you're familiar with the movie, you know ultimately it will end differently. But there are times in our lives where we have to make decisions. Decisions like, are we going to stay or are we going to go? Are we going to stay or are we going to go? Whether that is stay somewhere or go somewhere, or stay with someone or go from someone, or with another group of people or job, there's the decisions that we have to make. And they depend on who we are, what's best for us, and what road God is asking us to take. You know, there's a few things that make it additionally hard when we're trying to discern whether we can stay or whether we can go. You know, our emotions and connections with others, that makes it more difficult to discern. Our connections with places, our emotions with sometimes memories with places, that makes it difficult to discern if we should stay or if we should go, or just our own memories. That makes it difficult. I would even say that those are times that those emotions and connections are so strong, it's impeding us from figuring out the right thing to do. Discerning whether we should stay or go can be very difficult. It can be difficult for us to understand what God is asking us to do. You know, if it wasn't hard enough discerning through the heaviness of emotions and the connections we carry, there's something else that makes it difficult as well. I call it the God is with us conundrum. The God is with us conundrum. God is with us. That's part of the good news of the gospel. Because of what Jesus has done, no matter what decision we make, God says, I am with you always. That is great news. Don't get me wrong. That's great news. That is joyful news. So why in the world is it a conundrum? Why in the world would it be a problem? Because when we make a decision, we have to live with the results of those decisions. A lot of times, God says, I'm with you. And the reason why he says that is because he wants us to take responsibility for the decisions that we make. So we don't keep throwing it on God and say, it was on you, God. You told me to, God. That's beginning faith stuff. You know, beginning faith, people say, God told me to do it. God told me to do it. When you start to mature in your faith, God says, I'm with you. And part of that is God saying to you, whenever you make this decision, you have to take responsibility for this decision. And that can be very, very, very hard. What God will do is he will give us the wisdom and understanding to make the best decision possible. And oftentimes, when God wants us to discern us the right choice for us, he will give us clarity on what the best decision is. How does God give us clarity? I'm glad you asked. Let's go into our scripture for today. We are in the book of Ruth. The first character, I need to set this up a little bit for us. The first character we're going to focus in on, who will be an important character throughout our time today, is a woman named Naomi. Say Naomi. Amen. Naomi is the mother-in-law of Ruth. She's going to be the mother-in-law of Ruth and the mother-in-law of another woman named Orpah. So let's look at Naomi quickly before that time, before she becomes a mother-in-law. Well, Naomi and her husband were originally from Bethlehem. What is likely, early in their marriage, a severe famine hits the land and they have to leave Bethlehem. Now, whenever famine hit in antiquity, of course, you had to move to another place so you could go and get food. Nowadays, we have DoorDash. Anyone use DoorDash? I still haven't used it yet. Anyone out there use DoorDash? We got a few people. Yeah, you can, like, order something from Arby's and someone will go and pick it up for you and bring it to your door. Like, if fast food wasn't convenient enough, there's another step to do now. Now, they couldn't do that back in antiquity, of course. They had to move to a different place. Naomi, her husband, and family moved to the land of Moab. Now, years go by, and their two sons, get married. One of the sons marries Orpah. The other son marries a woman named Ruth. Now, as time goes on in the land of Moab, and with this family, tragedy does strike. It doesn't strike once. It doesn't strike twice. It actually strikes three times. We don't know exactly how it happens, but what happens is, Naomi's husband and two sons, they all die. Well, from this happening, obviously there's a change in season in Naomi's life, and she's distraught and trying to figure out, what should I do? Where should I go at this point now that her husband and sons had died? Well, at the same time, in the midst of her grief, she hears that back home in Bethlehem, God has blessed his people again, back in Bethlehem, God has blessed his people again by giving them crops. So Naomi wants to go back home. She's ready. She wants to go back home, and she does. Accompanying her are her two daughters-in-law, even though her sons have passed on, Orpah and Ruth. Now, they are not from Bethlehem, just to be clear. They are Moabite girls. Yet, they're going to go with Naomi to her homeland of Bethlehem. Why in the world would these two girls go? Well, there's two reasons. First of all, they actually, whenever they got married, they took on their husband's religion. The law of Moses required a younger son to marry the widows of his deceased brother. So in other words, Orpah and Ruth were supposed to wait for Naomi to have more sons, wait for them to grow up, then marry the sons. So the daughters-in-law were obliged to stay a part of Naomi's family. However, they were in Moab, they weren't in Judah, so they were surrounded by a culture that probably wouldn't enforce that. But here's the other reason, and the much more important reason to our time together today, why the girls are headed to Bethlehem, and they're forfeiting their lives. They have a high affection for Naomi. It seemed to go beyond, this affection went beyond regular respect and love for one another. There was a true connection between these young women and Naomi with these young women. Have you ever come across people in your path where you just feel like you got a tight connection with them? An emotional connection gets tied into all of that, and it's hard to kind of let that sever. That connection, I would say, in this story and how it's going to help us today was actually distracting all of them from whether the girls should go with Naomi to their homeland or stay home in Moab and start new families. Naomi, Ruth, and Orpah get packed up and ready to go. So they're ready to go. They start traveling together to go towards the road to Bethlehem. As they're on this road, Naomi realizes she cannot have the girls go with her. As much as she loves these girls, as much as the girls love her, Naomi knows the girls need to stay home, stay back in Moab. Naomi begins to show these feelings to us in verses 12 and 13. Let's take a look. This is Naomi speaking. "No, my daughters, return to your parents' home, for I am too old to marry again. And even if it were possible, and I were to get married tonight and bear sons, then what? Would you wait for them to grow up and refuse to marry someone else? No, Of course not, my daughters. Through these verses, church, Naomi is bringing clarity to her daughters-in-law. You know, whenever we are distracted about whether we should stay or whether we should go, we need to pray for God to give us clarity. Naomi, in these verses, is bringing clarity to Orpah and Ruth in three important ways. And we're going to glean some application where we can begin to get clarity if God is calling us to stay or go somewhere. So let's get into this. What is the first thing Naomi's saying to the girls for clarity? She's trying to tell them the road ahead is not glamorous. Naomi lets these girls know that she's saying to them, we all may have emotions right now, but the reality is what we're going to walk in is going to be difficult. Girls, where will you find work? Who will be your support system? It is not realistic that Naomi will have other sons. It's not realistic that then there will be sons that they can marry. If this was the 1990s, I would probably say Naomi is having a keeping it real type of talk with these girls. And then I found out this week, it's not keeping it real anymore. It's called a real talk moment. Well, that's what's happening right now in the scripture. And here's the application, friends. When we are discerning whether God wants us to stay or go, we have to focus and open up on the reality and the facts of the situation. We have to open up to the facts and reality of the situation. The connections we have with people, places, and jobs are important, but we cannot allow those things to distract us from our reality. If we let the connections and emotions we have with others distract us, there's a possibility that we may go down a road that we don't like. Let me give you a quick prayer to pray. If this is where you feel like this kind of first step is where you're at, let me give you a quick prayer to pray to begin this. Pray this. God, open me up to the reality of the situation I'm in. If you can't figure out, should I stay or should I go, ask God to open you up to the reality that you're in. When we open ourselves to the reality of our situation, we will get the facts and data that we need to discern what God is calling us to do. Naomi was having real talk in order for them to understand the reality of their situation. Here's the second way that she's helping them find clarity. Naomi was telling them that they may regret their decision. You know, every once in a while, we make a decision that we regret. Let me tell you about one I regretted last year, okay? I need to tell you, first of all, to start this off, I like my coffee, I like it to stay pretty hot or at least warm. So I'm never happy when I go and get a coffee because it takes me usually, I don't want to just like down a coffee. It takes me a little bit of time and I don't like it when it gets warm or cold within like 15 minutes. Well, last year, I went on a search for the perfect coffee cup that would make my coffee stay hot for some time. You know, it took me a while. It took me like 2 months to figure out where this coffee cup was at. But I found the perfect one from Target. And let me tell you, it was an awesome coffee cup. It kept my coffee hot for probably about an hour and a half, and it kept it warm for close to 3 hours. It was black. It was sleek. I loved carrying it around the office. And I was actually carrying it around here on Wednesday and Sundays as well. Then after about a couple months, someone said to me, Reverend Mike, why are you carrying around a woman's wine glass? I said, what? I said, this isn't a wine, it's a coffee cup. I've been using it for 2 months. They said, no, it's not. That's a woman's wine glass. I said, no way. They said, yeah, and it was. It was a woman's wine glass, okay? Then I start telling this story around places, like around here to some of you all. And people were like, yeah, we were wondering why you were carrying that around. It's like, why wouldn't anyone say anything to me for 2 months? I can tell you this, I deeply regret that decision. Luckily, I can just kind of get that cup out of my life. However, the decision Ruth and Orpah were going to make was going to be one that would last. They had to accept if they could live with the regrets of leaving Moab. You know, when we are discerning to stay or go, we have to figure out if we can live with the regrets of our decision. For instance, there may be a job out there that's your dream job, but if Can you, if you don't take that job, will you be able to live with the regrets of your decision? If you say, yeah, I think I can, then that might be a discerning factor God saying for you to stay. But if that comes up and you say, I can't live with the regrets of that, that may be a discerning factor of you saying that you should go. Finally, a third way Naomi brought clarity to the girls was by telling them that the path ahead was deeply spiritual. The path ahead of them would be deeply spiritual if they went with her. Now, Naomi didn't ultimately understand why she lost so much in her life. She didn't really actually understand what God was doing. But here's what Naomi was right about. There was simply something spiritual going on in her life. What she didn't know is that she was caught up in salvation history. Jesus Christ was actually going to come through her family line. And something very, very deeply spiritual was happening in her life. When we are discerning whether we should stay or go, we have to start to figure out, or at least this is something we should put into the equation, what path is the more spiritual path? Which road leads us closer to God? Which road helps us do more for his kingdom? God is with us always, hallelujah, but there is a path that God may be more in. That path possibly could be more challenging. That path may be more misunderstood, but ultimately, that path will be most rewarding. Well, Orpah and Ruth have heard these clarifying remarks from Naomi. They have a decision to make. Will they stay with Naomi, or will they go back home? Orpah knew what she needed to do. Orpah knew what she needed to do. Orpah knew that she needed to say goodbye to Naomi and to Ruth. Let's go to our next verse. And again they wept together, and Orpah kissed her mother-in-law goodbye. It's so hard to say goodbye to yesterday. It's originally an R&B song written by Motown husband and wife songwriter team, Freddie Perren and Christine Yarian. In the 1990s, it hit the top of the chart when redone by the group Boys to Men. This song is about the difficulty of saying goodbye.
How do I say goodbye to what we had? The good times that made us laugh, they outweigh the bad. I thought we'd get to see forever, but forever's gone away. It's so hard to say goodbye to yesterday. Don't know where this road is going to lead. All I know is where we've been and what we've been through. If we get to see tomorrow, I hope it's worth the wait. It's so hard to say goodbye to yesterday. And I'll take with me the yesterday.
Says goodbye to Naomi and leaves, and she's doing what is best for her. Orpah does what's best for her. But with Ruth, sure, something else is happening. Let's go to our next verses. But Ruth clung tightly to Naomi. "Look," Naomi said to her, "your sister-in-law has gone back to her people and to her gods. You should do the same." Now, there's a physical cling that Ruth had on Naomi, a hug, if you will, but it wasn't just that. Ruth was clinging to Naomi's heart. The person that Naomi was, Naomi's life direction, that is direction Ruth wanted to go in her life as well. What we're starting to see emerge in the text is because of this true connection, Ruth is going to have the ability to endure whatever is ahead. All those reality checks, all that real talk that Naomi was having with Ruth earlier, Ruth would be able to live through. Ruth, she was going to stay. Saying goodbye, it is hard, but sometimes we actually don't have to say goodbye. Sometimes the answer is to stay and not go. When I was discerning what seminary to go to, one of the seminaries I visited was on Northwestern University's campus, Garrett Evangelical Theological Seminary. It's really located in a very, very cool, beautiful place off of Lake Michigan. I loved the campus when I went there. I loved it. They had the Big Ten sports vibe going there for the college, and I didn't get to experience anything. I went to a smaller college, so I never had that. It had a beautiful view of the city. And in terms of the look and the feel of the campus, I mean, I was 100% blown away. When I saw how beautiful it was and how much I liked it, though, you know what I said to myself? This must not be for me because I like it too much. Have you ever done that before, that silly mindset where, like, it's so good to be true, that can't be for me? Well, I disqualified it because I liked what I saw too much. So I prayed just like this much about it, and I just kind of moved on and found a seminary that I didn't like as much. Goofy, I know. I know. But you know what happened? I started to go to that other seminary for a few weeks, and into the semester, I found out that the degree that I wanted to earn, that I would have earned, was no longer accepted for my ordination. So, guess where I went the next semester? Northwestern, Garrett Evangelical Seminary. I originally thought the connection I felt was too good to be true, so I said goodbye to it, when God was actually telling me that I needed to stay. Here's my point. Just because Orpah left Naomi in good conscience didn't mean Ruth was supposed to leave as well. Why didn't she leave? Why didn't Ruth leave? Because she sensed something beyond her connection to Naomi. Ruth sensed that God was up to something. That pull of staying with Naomi was not just relational. It was relational, it was. But it was beyond that. It was deeply spiritual. Let's go to our final verses. But Ruth replied, "Don't ask me to leave you and turn back. Wherever you go, I will go. Wherever you live, I will live. Your people will be my people, and your God will be my God." When Naomi saw that Ruth was determined to go with her, she said nothing more. The intensity of Ruth's feelings come out more strongly now that she pleads alone. Ruth is basically saying to Naomi, "Naomi, I get it. I get it. I get what you're saying, but I'm going to stay." With Orpah gone, Ruth's sincerity is shown as she's on her own now. And people of God, sometimes our sincerity is shown best when we have to make a decision that goes the opposite of others. There's an old hymn that many of you know called, "I Have Decided to Follow Jesus," and Some lines in the song go like this. Though none go with me, I still will follow. Though none go with me, I still will follow. Though none go with me, I still will follow. No turning back, no turning back. Ruth's argument to stay is sincere because there's no peer pressure trying to keep her. Naomi has released her. She is free to stay or go. She wants to stay. What's a final sign if you should stay or if you should go? It's if you will stick with the decision regardless if anyone makes the same decision or not. When you do that, when you feel that way, I would say, church, that you have peace. Ruth has forsaken everything else because she believes, even though it doesn't seem like it, something better lies ahead. Something better than her old home. Something better than her old life. There is something better for her. And when Naomi sees the way Ruth responds to staying, the Bible is saying that Naomi saw Ruth's determination was real. That Ruth's eyes were fixed on this journey with her. That Ruth was undistracted. I don't know what you might be discerning right now. And I know that our emotions and our connections to others and places can make it hard to figure out what to do. But I can tell you this, God gives you the freedom to choose which decision to make. And whenever you're making those decisions, all you got to do is make sure you're inviting God in to bring clarity, because that will be the best decision that you could ever make. Will you pray with me? Loving God, we thank you that there are times when you just say that you're with us. Sometimes those are scary times, God, because we want to feel your presence in the midst of every decision. And sometimes your presence doesn't come by you just revealing the exact road. Sometimes your presence comes with you giving us wisdom and clarity in what direction we should take. So anyone out there today who's needing that, God, we pray that you give that to them. We pray, God, that they hear what your word is saying to them and that they may have that peace that surpasses all understanding. We love you, God. We thank you that we could worship you and hear from you today. Through Jesus, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Mike. I get the privilege of being the student director here at Christ Church. And as I said earlier, we had an incredible week at camp. And I got to tell y'all, that doesn't happen without your faithful support and giving to Christ Church. When we get to feed the kids 12 times a day to keep their spirits up, when we can rent a golf cart for a leader because you have to walk 500 miles, all of these things, it adds up. And it does take money sometimes to make it happen. But y'all give generously, and that helps support of a full week of revival. If y'all would have seen what I got to see at camp this week, you'd be like emptying out your wallets this morning to make it happen again. It was that good. This morning, we are going to highlight two other ministries, the first of which is Backpack Attack. It's something that we support every year to fill backpacks up with supplies and dress clothes items for the kids to go back to school in. So please stop by the Scripture Hall on your way out. Check out the Giving Tree. They need things such as backpacks, folders. They need uniforms. They even need help delivering things. So what I like to do is challenge people, when you go out to buy school supplies for your kids, also buy one extra set of things for Backpack Attack and bring that into church. The next thing that we want to support this morning is R3. It used to be called Rebirth East St. Louis, and now it is R3. This is a phenomenal ministry. I mean, straight up phenomenal. I've been over there multiple times. I've got to work with their leader, Scott Loeffler. You can support this ministry wholeheartedly, knowing that what they're doing is affecting the kingdom forever. What they do is they take youth, they teach them how to work in places where work is not really supported. They're encouraging them biblically. And let me just read some statistics to you to get you pumped up about this ministry. 97% of students said they are using R3 to begin positive changes in their lives. 93% of students report growing in their faith as a result of interacting with R3. And 100% of students reported experiencing a greater sense of purpose as a result of interacting with R3. So if you are a retired guy that needs something to do, they need you at R3. If you're a married couple and you have something that you need to plug in with and you want to go help support them, they need you at R3. So what we're asking y'all to do today is just stop by the booth, hear Scott's heart about this ministry, and I promise you, you're going to get sucked in to wanting to help. All right? So when you support Christ Church, you're supporting all of these awesome ministries here at the church. As I pray for y'all, I'm going to invite the ushers up to come forward and take this morning's offering, and then we're going to watch a quick video. But let's pray. God, I just pray to you this morning, we do this morning, that you would encourage us to cheer, that you would encourage us to give cheerfully, Father. Sometimes it's hard, but God, I just pray that you would move amongst us to see the ministry that happens when we give you your tithes and our offerings. So make us happy about it. Remind us of the awesome things that you're doing with the financial gifts of the kingdom. But God, I also pray that you would move us to not only move financially, you'd also move us just spiritually and physically to get busy for your kingdom, God. And that we would do amazing things through the power that you give us in your Holy Spirit. I ask this in your name. Amen. Now we're going to take a quick look at our video to introduce you to our new director of adult discipleship, and the ushers, y'all can come forward to serve God's people.
Hi everyone, my name is Kevin Siddle, and I am the new director of adult discipleship here at Christ Church. My family and I have been coming to the church now for about 5 years. My wife Becky works back in Creation Corner, and I've also served here at church on the safety and security team. In this new role in Director of Adult Discipleship, it's something I'm incredibly passionate about. It's not enough to me to just connect with Jesus Christ, but we should have that transformation in a relationship with Christ. And so I'm excited to look at all facets of discipleship, whether it's Bible study or teaching, whether it's evangelizing or worshiping or giving. I firmly believe we all need to pour ourselves into these, and that we all have unique gifts and where we fit. And my hope and dream is just to connect people to their own goals, to connect people to their passions and into their ministries, so that as a bigger, broader church, we can do great ministry here and we can do great ministry outside of the walls of the church in the Metro East. And I just thank you so much for this opportunity and can't wait to serve you in whatever way God needs.
Amen, everybody. We're going to sing one more song. Will you stand with us? We're going to sing In Christ Alone, and we would love.
No fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand.
Thank you for this time in your house. God, be with us as we leave. Lord, thank you for filling us with your Spirit. Bless and protect us, God, and let your will be done in us. In your name, amen. Everybody, thank you for joining us. Have a great week. We will see you next Sunday. Go in peace.